Well, anybody remember the theme song to the last James Bond movie, Spectre, sung by Sam Smith, and it reached number one. And here's the chorus up on the screen here. How do I live? How do I breathe? I'm not going to sing it. When you're not here, I'm suffocating. I want to feel love run through my blood. Tell me, is this where I give it all up for you? I have to risk it all. Cuss. Well, it's obvious, isn't it? The writing's on the wall. It turns out that over 2,000 modern songs contain the lyric, the writing's on the wall. For the Bond theme, the writing on the wall is a sacrifice for love. For other songwriters, the writing on the wall is often the ominous breakup of a relationship. And the phrase has entered our language so that most of us instinctively know what it means. The writing's on the wall means that there are clear signs that things are going to get bad, very bad. What's usually missing in the popular use of the phrase, the writing's on the wall, is God. But take God out of the original story with the writing on the wall, and you reduce it to a story with little meaning or purpose. You see, the story we've read in Daniel chapter 5 is not just a courtly tale written for amusement and entertainment, though it is a good story with humour and written in a style which builds up tension and keeps us engaged. Neither is it a story primarily for us to learn about history, though it is that. The story is primarily here for us to learn about God. The motivations of the characters are bound up with their relationship to God, as is the substance of the story. I'm going to walk us through the passage under three headings and point out what it tells us about God. So in verses 1-6, God holds our life in his hand. And in verses 7-16, God's foolishness is wiser than our wisdom. And then finally, in verses 17-31, God weighs us in the balance. So first, God holds our life in his hand. The story begins with King Belshazzar throwing a great banquet. And this was a pretty big banquet. I looked it up. A typical state banquet at Buckingham Palace has about 150 guests these days. Well, Belshazzar has 1,000 nobles and his wives and his concubines. It's wine, women, and salt. And to be honest, the feast, great as it was, wouldn't deserve a mention if it wasn't that Belshazzar takes it upon himself to order the gold and silver vessels to be brought to the feast. And these are not just any old gold, silver goblets. They're the ones mentioned in the opening paragraph of the book. Now, I love it when a writer plants something early in a book, which only becomes significant much later. It's left there to simmer quietly in the background. So if you turn back to Daniel chapter 1, right at the beginning, it says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem, besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. And these he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasure house of his God. So these are the vessels from the temple in Jerusalem belonging to God, which God allowed to be taken to Babylonia and to lie in the temple of Nebuchadnezzar's God. And we know from the book of Ezra, which was written later, that there were over 5,400 of these articles because they were counted and itemized before they were eventually taken back to Jerusalem, which happened a bit later. But in the meantime, they've been lying there, undisturbed, waiting for their return to where they belong in the rebuilt temple in Jerusalem. But Belshazzar has other ideas. He wants them to drink out of, and crucially, to praise the gods of gold, silver, bronze, iron, wood, and stone. So this is wine, women, and wickedness. As Daniel explains later in the chapter, what Belshazzar was doing was setting himself against the Lord of heaven. It's verse 23. He was deliberately defying God by using something that belonged to the Lord of heaven, to somehow promote his own gods. Basically, he was saying, my gods are greater than your God. He was spitting in the face of the Jews and their God, the one true God, thumbing his nose at God, openly defiant, no respect, just mockery and arrogance. Instead of honouring God, to whom these vessels belonged, he was praising his own gods. His own gods, as Daniel says, that can neither hear nor understand. But of course, God heard and he understood. And suddenly, the fingers of a human hand appear and begin to write on the plaster of the wall near to the king. And as he watches, his face turns pale and he becomes so afraid that his legs go weak and his knees begin to shake uncontrollably. He's reduced to a quivering wreck. What a fool. What a fool to have defied God, because only a fool would do such a thing. Paul says in Romans chapter 1 that this is so often the way that humans behave. Although they claim to be wise, they become fools and exchange the glory of the immortal God for idols, Romans 1:22. And in rejecting God and becoming filled with all kinds of wickedness, Paul says, although they know God's righteous decree, that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them, Romans 1:32. And that's what Daniel will be keen to point out. Belshazzar knew all that happened to Nebuchadnezzar before him, that we looked at last week in chapter 4. And he knew that when Nebuchadnezzar became proud and arrogant, he was humbled by God until he acknowledged that the Most High God is sovereign over all the kingdoms of the earth. He knew all that, and yet he failed to humble himself. Instead, he openly set himself against the Lord of heaven. He didn't honor God, even though God holds in his hands his life and all his ways, as Daniel says later. But God says to Belshazzar what he also says to us as well. We might not be in positions of power and influence on the world stage, but God knows all of us as individuals. And just like Belshazzar, he holds our life and our ways in his hands. He gives and he takes away. When we die and how we die is in his hands. We may have a long life or a short life. We may live on for years from today, or we may die this week. God knows, even if we do not. We just don't know what is around the corner. Last Sunday, there was news about a cable car in Italy that tragically and catastrophically snapped and the gondola crashed to the ground, killing most on board. I think there was just a five-year-old boy as a survivor. Now, it's a really popular tourist attraction that whisks you up to the top for superb views of the Lake Maggiore below and the mountains in the distance. I know, because I've been on it. And you can't help thinking when you see something like that happen, if you've been on it yourself, that could have been me. I'm reminded of my own mortality and the fragility of life. Of course, closer to home, the pandemic has heightened the sense of our own mortality, for most of us at least. Jesus told the parable of a man who owned great wealth. He'd made a fortune and decided that having done all the hard work, it was time for him to retire, to take it easy, to enjoy his wealth. "You fool," said God, "this very night your life will be demanded of you, just like Belshazzar." And knowing that our life is in God's hands can be a comfort or a discomfort. It's a comfort if we know that we are right with God. Nothing can separate us from his love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. But it's a challenge if we've neglected God and not put him first in our lives. What will happen to us when we die? Do you know? Are you sure? What does the writing on the wall say to you about your eternal destiny? Well, secondly, God's foolishness, we discover, is wiser than human wisdom, verses 7 to 16. What does Belshazzar do? Well, does he realize he's made a stupid and stupendous mistake, fall down on his knees and repent? Well, not a bit of it. He summons the wise men. Now, we've met these before, these wise men, in this book, in chapter 2, when Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. They were useless then, and they are useless now. If ever a government department needed a serious overhaul, then this was it. And if Belshazzar is looking to human wisdom to get him out of this hole, he's looking in the wrong place. If he thinks he can summon up wisdom from his gods, he's badly mistaken. And when he realizes that this isn't going to work, he becomes even more terrified. The thought of what this writing on the wall portends has shaken him to the core. He's absolutely petrified. And we know that he's quite right to be. Then to the rescue comes the queen. She's not been at the banquet for some reason. She may in fact be the queen mother, since his wives were all at the party. And she strides into the chaos and seems to take command of the situation. "Don't be alarmed. Don't look so pale. There's a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy gods in him," she says in verse 11. And she tells him about Daniel, giving a pretty outstanding testimonial. He's the one who can explain riddles and solve difficult problems. Call for Daniel and he'll tell you what the writing means. Now, her sensible, calm and confident solution stands in marked contrast to the king's reaction. And the king, who already seems pathetic and fearful and powerless, is made to look even weaker by a female. Yes, a female in a man's world, taking command of the situation. Do you see what's happening? God is dismantling Belshazzar's wisdom, his self-importance and arrogance, bit by bit. And so Daniel appears. And the first thing Belshazzar says to him is, "Are you Daniel, one of the exiles my father brought from Judah?" At some point, he's worked out that Daniel is a Jew. He's one of the people Nebuchadnezzar deported from Judah, along with the gold and silver articles from the temple. And by now, Belshazzar must have worked out that the writing on the wall was about to be interpreted by someone whose God he had openly defied. The defeated captive, whose God he had openly mocked, stands before him, and he might well be the one to explain the mystery and determine his fate. The king has despised Daniel, and he's despised Daniel's God, yet Daniel is the only one left who can help him. Belshazzar thought he had the wisdom of the world at his fingertips, but it counted for nothing. he's reduced to relying on his mother and a Jew to whose God he's shown defiance and contempt. God has undermined Belshazzar's wisdom and brought wisdom to him through what he regards to be foolish. And that's the way God so often works. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 27 to 29, that God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. What God values is not wisdom or strength, but what seems to many to be foolishness and weakness. And that's shown supremely in Jesus. That's how he came to us in Christ, in weakness and humility. That's the message of the cross. To so many, it's foolishness and weakness. But for us who believe, it's the wisdom and the power of God. You sometimes feel as if you're one of the few who gets it. So many around you imply that you're weak and foolish to believe in the power of the cross. But God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom. God turns human wisdom on its head. So thirdly, God weighs us in the balance. So Daniel begins to tell Belshazzar what it all means. And these are the words on the wall. Mene, mene, tekel, and parsin. And it turns out to be a word puzzle. In Aramaic and Hebrew, all you have is the consonants. The vowels are missing. And if you insert one set of vowels, you get a series of weights or coins. A mina, a shekel, and two halves. So basically, if we modernized it, it would read something like a pound, a 5 pence, and 2 50-pence pieces. Well, no wonder no one could work out what that meant, even if they could decipher the words themselves. But Daniel, under God's direction, solves this. He inserts a different set of vowels and makes up three verbs from the consonants: numbered, weighed, and divided. Mene produces the verb to count or to number. And he says, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. You have been weighed, he says, on the scales and found wanting. And Perez is the singular of the word passing, produces the verb to divide or the word Persian. Your kingdom will be divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Well, what's Belshazzar's reaction? He's obviously convinced that this is the interpretation. It makes sense. And he rewards Daniel. But it makes no difference to him. In the face of God's judgment and condemnation, he refuses to repent. And that very night, he is slain and his kingdom taken from him. And like Belshazzar, our lives will also be weighed on the scales. It's an image that many have of what will happen at the final judgment. God will weigh our good and our bad. And if the good outweighs the bad, we'll be okay. If it doesn't, we'll be condemned. Well, if that's how it works, I've got bad news for you. We are all going to be condemned. No amount of goodness will outweigh our sins. The Bible talks about our sin being a debt, and that debt being enormous. It's so great that we could not possibly hope to pay it off, to outweigh it with our goodness. But the good news is that God, in his grace, has paid the debt himself through his son Jesus. Through his death on the cross, he's paid the price for our sin. Our sins are forgiven if we put our faith and our trust in Jesus' death on the cross. And foolish as that is for many to believe in, it's true. It is the wisdom and the power of God. It's not our merits that count, but Jesus' merit. And God can then say, not guilty. Though the scales weigh against us because Christ has died in our place, we are not guilty. At the final judgment, there will therefore be no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Are you trusting in Christ? Are you confident in the power of his death on the cross for your salvation? Well, as I close, let me encourage you today to consider these things. God has your life in his hands. Trust in him with your life. Are you trusting him with your life? God's foolishness is wiser than our wisdom. Trust in what so many regard as the foolishness of the cross, because it is the wisdom and the power of God. And God weighs us in the balance. Trust in Jesus and his death as the only way to be saved from God's judgment. Let me challenge you today. Are you trusting in God? Are you trusting in Jesus? Your life is in his hands. But if you trust in him, you can be confident of your eternal destiny. Let's pray as we finish. Father God, we thank you that you hold our life in your hands. Help us to recognize the fragility of our own mortality. Our lives are like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it and it's gone. Help us to trust that nothing can separate us from the love that you have for us in Christ Jesus. We thank you for the cross. Foolishness to many, but the wisdom and the power of God to those who believe. Thank you that Jesus' death means that if we've placed our trust in you, the future judgment holds no terror. We're secure in Christ's grace and the mercy of God. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.